It's really hot.
I just want to make sure. I only ask because I want to make sure it's not because I'm like feverishly.
No, it's hot. It's really hot.
Weather-wise, this is not my environment. I was not aware how quickly I could become sunburned. The sun is constantly roasting you. My entire body, head to toe, literally my toes are sunburned. Right now, I'd actually die. I'm trying to put on a brave face, maybe make some self-deprecating comments around camp, like, oh yeah, I look like a lobster, I look like a freak, haha, it's funny. I'm actually in horrible pain right now, and I feel like crying, kind of, but I'm, you know, trying to stay strong. I mean, my new persona is strong, a little bit of swagger, a little more confidence. I can't be the same freak I was last time.
Oh, there it is. Give me like a good...
Sunburn aside, I have basically instant rapport with I'd say everybody on my tribe. Is intensely satisfying. It's basically the aloe to my sunburn, as it were. Yeah, coming into this game, I was a little bit skeptical of how Dawn would react to me, because I arguably screwed her over last time. I voted her out. So I wasn't sure if there was going to be any lingering resentment or what was going to be the case.
See, I like Francesca. I was kind of like hoping that...
I don't trust Franny for the long haul, because she's going to play to win. So to me, that's a person that's like, take out. You know, Philip, medium.
I'm willing to work with her. She's honest to a fault, unless she's kind of reinvented herself over the past year and decided to play a much more cutthroat game, which actually she might be. The fact that she's willing to take out Franny, who she's confessed to really liking and wanting to work with, indicates that this is a new Dawn. A new Dawn.
Mind me a conversation.
I'm gonna drown myself in the ocean.
Oh no.
You know, in weighing whether I want to vote off somebody like Francesca, there is kind of this emotional aspect. You can say you want to play the most strategic, cold-blooded game in the world, but emotions do enter the equation. The fact that I like her doesn't help. So there's a part of me that's like, maybe I shouldn't vote her off just because that would be cruel. It feels like, I feel like it's inhumane. Like, you don't know. I mean, I have, like, morals, right? I have a sense of shame. One of the most frightening things about Brandon's personality is that he has these moments of extreme rage, and they're almost immediately followed by unbelievable pleasantness. The sort of behavior befitting a murderer who is kind of sociopathic.
I like our tribe. I really do.
Philip, you're not interrupting nothing.
Okay. The only thing I can predict about Brandon is that he's going to be unpredictable, and that gives me very little solace in this game, where predictability really is everything.
Cert clear, and it cools you.
You know, back at home, I'm waiting the whole week long for Wednesday night at 8 to arrive so I can turn on CBS and see what's in store. I have to sit in the magical seat today.
Yeah, get to sit in the seat. I could crown you.
But when you're playing this game, every single day is like Wednesday night at 8. It's wild, and that's what I love. I get to watch Survivor while I'm playing Survivor, and for a Survivor nut like I am, this is a dream come true.
This is great. I don't know why I don't know why, like, in the rest of the world people don't do this.
Because they're not the specialists.
The weird thing is that it's not normal for me to be surrounded by all these beautiful women who are half the time just wearing their underwear. I mean, that's some sort of Freudian picnic, I think. But it's real here.
So the Favorites Wonder Award Challenge, and we got to have a local bushman come to camp and introduce us to ways of improving our camp and actually physically improving it for us, as well as cooking a great feast for us.
Okay, cook rice.
As we got to form as much of a rapport as you can form with somebody like Tata, the bushman, we got a sense of how he functions. And the way he functions is basically saying enigmatic little things that nobody understands.
Okay, here in the jungle, no kitchen, right?
No bitching in the jungle. I like that.
But to his credit, he created an unbelievable feast for us. I mean, we've been eating rice. He prepared this rice flawlessly, like you'd get it at a great restaurant. And he made chicken and potatoes and onions, created like in a way that ostensibly we could do once he's gone. I have no idea what the hell he was doing, but it was great to watch. It was kind of, you know, dinner and a show. And, you know, actual home improvement came along with it. Yeah. Tata's a married man, but that didn't seem to impede him from really trying to get his bump and grind on with the girls of the Favorites tribe. Since he's kind of this bizarre little woodland creature, he gets away with it. If I tried that, I'd seem like I was some creepy predator. But the girls found it delightful. They even were all kissing him on the cheek, which I'm sure will provide him with fodder for years to come in his mind and heart.
One of us will win this thing.
When Brandon was here, it was actually like a certified asylum. It's comforting to know that Brandon was able to successfully fly over the cuckoo's nest, and now we're just left with Philip.
They're out.
I did not give a damn.
It seems relatively clear to me that one of the fans is going to go home tonight. I kind of like the idea of voting off Julia, but a possible downside is that Matt and Michael are openly very close to each other. So leaving an outspoken duo, a power couple, in this game doesn't seem to make that much strategic sense.
Michael and I, we've been really gung-ho and just starting fresh, you know what I mean? We haven't really talked a lot strategy-wise. I don't know where Philip lies, if he's the kingpin and this and that, but...
Matt, I'm pretty sure he doesn't have the idol because he reeks of desperation right now. But for now, it seems like it's between Matt and Julia with, who knows, if an idol's played, maybe it's me, maybe it's Corinne, maybe it's Philip.
The tree mail did say the strong will carry the weak. We have plenty of that latter category. So if the success of this challenge depends on the existence of weak people, we got it.
Down like that.
Philip challenged me to an arm wrestling match. He naturally was able to beat me quickly.
You can put both hands on it. Go ahead. Ready? Go. Put my hand down. Put all your weight on it, man. Get on your knees.
Then to up the ante and also to build up his ego a little bit, Philip demanded that I actually basically put all my weight on his one hand. Okay, you're proving your incredible strength. I put a significant portion of my weight on his forearm, and he managed to keep it off the ground. And the smile on Philip's face after that, I think he felt like the old Philip, or the young Philip.
I want to keep playing the game with him.
Yeah. Philip and Corinne hate each other. There's so much fracture and division within the favorites on this tribe, it's like a death sentence. I mean, something is going to happen at one point or another.
It's a joke.
I'm going to be pushing that we certainly vote off a fan, which is not even a certainty at this point, because Michael actually seems capable of wheeling and dealing. He's already gotten very, very close with Corinne.
If you have any ideas on how we can reel him in, please let me know.
Julia, on the other hand, is such a non-entity out here. I'm tempted to say that she has like a vanilla personality, but I feel like that would be doing a great disservice to the flavor vanilla. I mean, people actively seek out vanilla-flavored products. Children clamor to get a vanilla ice cream cone. Nobody's clamoring for anything Julia-flavored.
Except for Philip.
Philip has grown very, very close to Julia. And I'm not exactly sure why. So when we got back to camp, spirits were understandably a little bit low. We just lost. And Philip, he just kind of was sulking around, kind of eyeing out everybody. And then he quickly and very covertly pulled me aside and whispered very intensely. And you know, my mind starts racing instantly. Has he done something around camp? Is he gonna betray Corinne tonight? What could it possibly be?
Okay, I couldn't see Julie at the merge.
It all makes sense. We had to throw the challenge in order to get rid of one of these fans, or else we were doomed. And that's the only reason why Philip was unable to successfully throw a grappling hook. I mean, it's complete crap.
It hit me once I saw it was the grappling hook. I'd just make a gallant effort, but it just won't quite be where it needs to be, because I would have tossed it slightly differently. I wouldn't have been winding it up like that.
You can't make up this level of delusion, and that's what excites me about playing with Philip. I think he's actually at this point convinced that he threw the challenge.
Of some of the razzle-dazzle?
And slowing it down, pulling it back. Okay, I wouldn't have done it that way. I would have been hustling to get it back.
Yeah.
He wasn't throwing the challenge. He was trying his hardest. He was in full spy mode. Can you imagine the speech he would have given back at camp had he successfully thrown a grappling hook, the spy's basic tool, in a challenge and won the challenge for us? It's just... it's absurd.
I have to make sure he doesn't have the idol.
The numbers within this current tribe are 4 favorites and 2 fans. That numbers advantage means that the 4 of us can split our votes across the 2 remaining fans, flush out any possible idols, and on the revote, we can get rid of Julia. Philip wants to vote off Michael. I don't know if this is a plan that's set in stone, but it clearly has nothing to do with Julia or with Michael. It's masking something that's about to come to the surface. And tonight's vote will probably be what sets into motion a series of events that completely bring this Philip-Corinne feud to the surface and make it clear why they can't play together. Seeing the vote coming and the merge had arrived, which is always the part of the game that I'm most excited about.
About to hook up with the chick, she's like, didn't you eat like a cow? She's like...
Eddie was worried that this might damage his dating prospects, that he's going to be viewed as somebody that's partaken in something very gross and, you know, potentially alienating women. For me, you know, I need some sort of image rehabilitation. I think this would add a little bit of a wild streak to me and might make me seem a little bit more dangerous.
I think this is exactly what my love life needs. Today's immunity challenge, it was a true Survivor classic. And the fact that I got to the final round, and that the final round was between me, this little pipsqueak, and Malcolm, the golden god of this tribe, and the fact that I won is dream fulfillment.
You're a true survivor.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great job. Great job. We're all happy for you.
I did have this kind of over-the-top, somewhat obnoxious victory celebration because I know this moment probably isn't going to happen again. Any other individual having that sort of display of basically bad sportsmanship, it would have rubbed them the wrong way. But somehow, everybody seemed happy for me.
But now I finally know the thrill of victory.
That's what he does to me all the time.
Corinne was adamant that we not target Reynold and Eddie, which I don't fully understand. But if Sherry goes, you know, no sweat off my back, Sherry's an easy vote, and, you know, her elimination would lock the favorite's numbers in a way that would be irreversible.
I think at this point we need to make a statement to him.
Look, but if he's completely outnumbered, he's not going to be some, like, vocal minority about it.
What doesn't bode well is the fact that Corinne and Philip hate each other and they have a suspicion of each other that's unhealthy. And if the favorites don't come together, that's basically admitting to the world, fans included, that we're a dysfunctional group that doesn't completely trust each other, that there are openings for them to enter, and that we're apt to fall apart given, you know, the right catalyst.
Those guys are in her back pocket now.
Dawn just approached me, very frantic, saying that Corinne let it be known that apparently she's rallied this group of troops together that gives her the numbers and it gives her post-merge control of the game.
And we're gonna take out Sherry. So we'll be at 11, and they still at 6. We should have been voting out Reynold already. Then it's a tie.
Corinne, who I thought didn't have a strategic bone in her body, she's positioned herself in a way that we've been basically acquiescing to every single demand she's made. So it's a sobering situation. And if we don't come up with a plan, it could be devastating to my game and the games of my allies. Now, it's disconcerting that my fate in this game right now rests in the hands of somebody like Sherry, who's just desperate for some sort of footing in this game. And then you have Eric, the ice cream scooper, a guy who doesn't like strategy, and somebody who's basically proven himself previously to be incompetent at playing this game. We get to the reward location, and there's this brilliant waterfall, 40 or so feet tall, and we're gonna have to rappel down it. I'm gonna have to rappel down it. This is not something I do.
Once you're there and you're looking at the wall, focus on the wall. You can't focus on the down. You have to focus on the wall.
I'm going to look down. I'm going to focus on the front.
I rarely leave my apartment. I rarely leave Twitter. And the fact that I'm going to be flung down some waterfall on a rope, I don't even know the mechanics of it. I have no idea what's going on.
In a world.
Go down the waterfall. It wasn't much consolation because I had no idea what they were doing.
But I'm learning to embrace it. This is the same guy that was afraid to take off his shirt the last time I played Survivor. Now I'm flying down a waterfall after winning a challenge. It was fantastic. Still a little bit nerve-wracking because I kind of slid on some mossy rocks and bungled the, you know, the job a little bit, but I loved it.
Survivor big moment. I like that.
Yeah. Reynold, Eddie, and Michael must not know me that well if they think that emphasizing the testosterone unity between us and we're men and we hate women and we're gonna, you know, slap each other with towels in the locker room and chug beers. That doesn't work with me. It doesn't appeal to me at all.
All right,
I don't want to be engaging in any sort of masculine tomfoolery with these numbskulls.
Right?
Yeah, if you're in danger, then yeah, I'm fine doing my thing.
Frankly, I was a little bit turned off that Andrea was so willing to abandon what I think was the smartest aggressive move in taking out Malcolm tonight.
I mean, the safest bet ever would be Michael.
I still like Malcolm.
I know, but you're not being, I think I'm being targeted.
She's completely changed her mind, and now suddenly we have to go for the safe vote, which would be to vote out Michael. Because Michael, unlike anybody else, has proven, you know, time and time again in Tribal Council not to have an idol.
We are absolutely, all the work I did today is completely down the...
Enjoy your afternoon.
Thank you.
Forgive us for starving.
Reynold, Don, Eric, Philip, and I walked into our reward resort, and we were greeted by a table filled to the brim with all sorts of shrimp kebabs, beef kebabs, fried chicken, calamari. There was more food than we could possibly eat.
I have not had any beef in well over a month.
Oh, goodness.
Apparently protein is important in one's diet. And this was the sort of energy I needed to be able to go into challenges and continue being the challenge monster I think I've proven myself to be.
There's a bar of soap.
Think
if you do exactly like you normally do.
Yeah.
On days like today.
Yeah.
Dawn's convinced that Andrea is going to flip over and vote her, Dawn, out. How Dawn is so confident she's the person that would be on the receiving end of this vote is baffling to me. And it's making me suspicious of Dawn, quite frankly.
I cry more than a baby, literally.
We had one who flew over the cuckoo's nest at this camp, Brandon Hans. He's gone. But it's looking like there's another, you know, possible little hummingbird that's zipping over the cuckoo's nest, and her name's Dawn.
I'm so tired of crying.
Take a walk.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Now that Dawn's settled down, we were on the eve of another tribal council. Stealth R Us, being led by Philip, decided it'd be good to kind of get our, you know, ducks in a row and say, okay, who are we really voting off tonight?
Who do you want? Reynolds and Elton first.
We have 7 people against their 3. We're going to split the vote because we can throw 4 votes to Reynolds. And just in case he does play an idol or something goofy happens, we'll throw the other 3 votes to Malcolm and flush out any possible idols. I don't mean to get too confident, but my alliance has the numbers and I couldn't be happier.
Day 29.
I've participated in and certainly viewed hundreds of tribal councils. Never before have I seen anything quite like what happened last night at tribal council. It left me breathless. It left me terrified. Today's been a pretty rough day around camp. People are really hungry and spirits have been low and it's driving everybody crazy. I saw there were 9 envelopes sitting there, and I know what that means as a Survivor fan. It means that the food auction is upon us.
Yep, $500 in cash.
Yeah, which is surprising for me.
I know, that's what last time I remember.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
I've been trying hard to play this like a motionless game this time. So just be this calm, cool, collected game bot that just runs through strategy. And, you know, getting letters from home makes me realize there is life outside the game and things I value more than this game. And part of me is a little bit happy that I'm still a person who values family and love and I guess the things that are really important.
I feel like an idiot, though. Like,
why?
I don't know.
I am the greatest challenge competitor in Survivor Caramelli. There's no debate. If you look at the scoreboard, I'm demolishing everybody. I've won half the individual immunity challenges. I'm the guy that was screamed at after every challenge last time I played because I'm such a freaking liability because I suck in challenges because I'm weak.
The advantage is big.
But now I am the biggest challenge threat in this game. And I don't care if it makes me a threat. I'm just going to keep winning.
In a row? Yeah, I don't want to go.
It's not going to happen.
The fans are desperate. They're cornered. They have no power. The power rests in the favorites right now. And I want to take away as much power and suck it up for myself as possible because I want to take control of the game, and I'll do it without remorse. I'll do it without any reservations, and it's scary that I'm saying that. I feel like I've turned into something that would scare my mother if she saw me, but I'm not the little Harvard nerd who was trembling in the bushes last time.
I hope it was worth it.
Damn, it's all good.
It might have been a big mistake stepping out of the game, but I couldn't last that much longer. As long as one of us wins immunity, it's fine. The goal is to keep it out of the hands of Reynolds.
Reynolds!
Give me some.
Eric finds the idol, and I'm thinking, fantastic. I can probably tell him what to do with the idol, and he'll do it. And before I even have a chance to start celebrating, he's already handing the idol over to Andrea. Does he learn nothing?
Thank you, Andrea.
She hasn't pissed anyone off.
I think today's immunity challenge and the fight demonstrated by players like Andrea and Brenda marked possibly the beginning of the end for the Alliance of 6. We still have these 2 easy votes in Reynolds and Eddie. We can split the votes between the 2 of them and one will be sent packing. And yet, we're seeing these self-interested desires bubbling to the surface and people that are playing for the end game now to secure their own victory instead of a group victory.
But let's talk to the get Liz, Arnold. That's what makes it good.
Andrea is a smart player and Andrea, like me, is thinking well beyond the 6. And it's Andrea's opinion that the right big move to make is to blindside Brenda. She could go on an immunity streak. She's one of the more capable challenge competitors in this game, but this game is all about timing.
Eric's gonna be cool with this.
Probably.
Andrea, I think, is one of the few remaining independent thinkers, and that's a dangerous thing. And the time to make a big move is rapidly approaching. So if Andrea doesn't win the next immunity challenge, and she doesn't play the idol, she might be going home.
If he's stuck in there, then Dawn or Brenda, I think.
I haven't been able to mention Eddie's name for the past 10 days without Andrea saying, no, Eddie's harmless. I control his vote. He's fantastic. He's great. And now it all makes sense. She wants to go to the final three with him.
She was talking about Eddie slipping the finals. Like, she's already banking on Eddie.
She's going to have to go.
I know. I know. Whether it's personal, whether it's strategic, I don't know. But the fact of the matter is, Eddie's moving up on Andrea's priority list. So I'm worried that I'm going to be replaced by Eddie. I admire Andrea for having a game plan. But that plan doesn't include me. I want to be a part of everybody's plan. And if I'm not a part of your plan, Andrea, you're not going to be a part of mine.
The only winner playing the idol, obviously.
Right.
Totally in our best interest to split the vote.
Gotcha.
Once again, I have to trust Eric, the ice cream scooper who gave up his idol and was promptly voted out. And that's scary.
I'm so happy that
you run for the group would be voted for.
I always thought, I'm the little worthless, scrawny, annoying twerp who's not good at challenges. Of course everyone's going to go to the end with me. But now I'm kind of taking a step back and looking at myself and thinking, wait, can I really get to the end of this game? Or do I have an expiration date that's, you know, rapidly approaching? Summer of 2000, I'm 13 years old, sitting on the couch at home with my mom, watching Survivor Borneo. Over the next 13 years, still been watching it, never missed an episode. You know, I've gone through my first kiss, puberty, a little bit more than that. And this is the culmination of 13 years of loving this, and loving this with somebody I love, and getting to share this now with somebody I love. It, you can't beat it. My dad, the neurologist, kind of a bookish guy. He's wearing sunglasses all of a sudden, and he's working the grill like an old pro. I think he was putting up kind of an act to seem like a cool dude when he's anything but. I mean, he's basically me in 40 years. I don't know if he's gone Hollywood or what's going on, but he's flipping burgers and poking at hot dogs on a grill. Like, since when are we doing that, Dad?
Cochran?
Oh, my part of the family?
You want it yet?
So much.
At the time that Brenda made her decision to give up her reward and let the four other survivors enjoy it, there was a sense, oh my God, Brenda is fantastic. She is selfless. This is unbelievable. This is a game-winning move. That's actually what my mom whispered to me. She said, Brenda's going to win this game.
Thanks for everything today, Brenda. I love you.
I love both of you.
But the better and more likable and more untouchable Brenda seems, the more people are going to want to get her out. Because we're at that point in the game where likability is a liability. And I know that better than anyone else, and I think Brenda's going to be experiencing that soon, if I have any say in it.
Cochran's starting to slip.
I'm not going to be jumping out of this challenge. I want to win it. But if Eddie wins immunity, it's going to be a pretty stressful day at camp.
Go first, buddy. You go first.
Eddie, is this a battle between who's going to go in first, between you and Cochran?
No.
Me?
Yep.
If I had my pick between Eddie and Brenda, personally, I'd like to have Brenda go. I think it's a great move that benefits me and actually even indirectly benefits Dawn and Sherry. But I'm thinking, okay, the problem with that is that everybody is so gung-ho about getting Eddie out. I mean, there was a foregone conclusion when we got back to camp. So I thought this is going to be a pretty hard sell.
So the good news is we've guaranteed ourselves final four. Like, you realize that, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I have a scenario for tonight, but I don't think Don will go along with it. I mean, I'm not even sure if it's worthwhile, but I just like running through them.
Me too. That's kind of where I know. Can I guess what your scenario is going to be?
Sure.
Blindside Brenda tonight.
Yeah.
Because she would never see it coming. Everyone's already there.
It is the perfect move because tonight is the perfect night to make it. If Brenda had one more day in this game, she could upset everything. There are only a few days left. She could go on a winning streak. She would win at the final tribal council. I'm making sure that doesn't happen.
Halfway through it.
When I looked at Eric, I saw somebody that was very dazed and looked disoriented and just kind of out of it. He was swirling his hands around his head. And I feel bad for him. I know he's a super fan like I am.
Everything's so hungry.
We all get back to camp, kind of exchange a few sad pleasantries about the state of affairs. And I'm already thinking about the game. I'm a little bit more pumped than ever that now I'm in the final four. And my first thought is, I have to be the first person to get to Eddie. Eddie is somebody that I haven't really bonded with that closely, but I need to get into his good graces, since he's probably the guy most likely to win the next immunity challenge and therefore to be in a position of power to determine who goes to the final three. My great challenge streak, which was temporarily on hold, has come roaring back. I stacked a house of cards better than any of my opponents, and won not only, you know, the thrill of being another victor in another challenge, but an advantage in the upcoming final immunity challenge. I am the challenge beast.
Halt was awesome. Good job.
Pretty good.
Third immunity. Great. I mean, third win.
Yeah.
This could be a $1 million advantage. So winning the advantage was huge, not only because it potentially could help me, but because I kept it out of the hands of some people I don't want to have had it. I was scared that Eddie might get the advantage. I also didn't particularly want Dawn to have it in case I decided I want her to go instead. So it's in the right hands, it's in capable hands, and I'll see what happens.
Breaking away, you know, it's like adds
right.
Anxiety.
Every day I get to see a new freak out from Dawn. There's the over-the-top weeping, sobbing, flailing of arms, asking to be left alone. Unfortunately, today, Dawn was leaning more towards the catatonic breakdown, and a lot of it had to do with the sudden influx of paranoia that she's having, that what if Eddie and Sherry take her out?
Vulnerable, you know.
Yeah. Dawn feels like she automatically deserves a fast pass to the finals. Why exactly? I don't know. Every day is a roller coaster with her, and it's not fun, it's not funny. On day 37, she should be paranoid, because I am considering ditching her. So we received a tree mail today, letting us know that today is the day of our final immunity challenge. But in addition to that, it's the famous survivor rites of passage. It's something I've been actually really looking forward to, hoping that I'd get to see this moment in the game. And it's kind of a nostalgic moment, where you get to reflect on the past 38 days and look forward to the day ahead of us. It couldn't have gone any better, and I'm actually in a position of power. I mean, Sherry wants to work with me, Eddie wants to work with me, and Dawn wants to work with me, and I have my, you know, pick of the litter. So there's a little devil on my shoulder that's saying, man, I just want to get rid of Dawn.
I'm still a little bit in disbelief.
I, Cochran, have won 4 individual challenges. So right now I'm thinking, okay, I got the million. You know, the big question now is, who deserves $100,000 in second place?
How are you feeling?
I don't think it's fully set in yet. I mean, you know, this is 13 years.
I know. Believe me, I know.
Yeah.
It's not going to be Sherry. Sherry might be able to squeak out one vote, but she's not going to get enough to get second place. So now it's about, do I want to bring Dawn with her constant emotional outbursts, or Eddie, a chauvinistic 23-year-old idiot?
Pretty cool.
It was just like an epic survivor day.
Yeah.
The battle for second place is a really heated one, and I can't wait to see what happens. It's so lonely at the top. This is horrible stuff for me to be saying, but I, of course, lose. I have to figure out who is less of a threat in terms of me being able to bring home $1 million in the title. I know Sherry's going to go to the end with me, and I can beat her. The bigger question mark is, can I beat Eddie, or can I beat Dawn? They're both people that bring a lot of pros and cons to the table. I hope I don't kick myself over this decision. The first time in 39 days I've really felt frazzled is today. I've written a prize-winning paper at Harvard Law School on the survivor jury system. There's a big difference between writing a paper and living out the reality, and I'm grappling with that dichotomy right now. Law school hasn't prepared me for this. You'd think it would. Sorry, Harvard, you haven't really taught me that much about how to address a jury. But I'm going to learn my lesson tonight, I think. Whenever things are looking good for me, I suddenly start expecting the worst and preparing myself for the worst. Am I going to be able to get onto Survivor, which I've been dreaming of doing for half my life? No, I'm a loser. They're never going to want somebody like me. And I get on, and I get to return as a favorite. And, you know, this endgame scenario is no different. I feel like I've played a great game. I've gotten to the end. This is my game to lose. But all of a sudden, these doubts are plaguing my mind. I'm just kind of this awkward geek who hasn't really done anything. I know I've done stuff, and I know I can express myself, but this doubt just creeps in, or seeps in. And it's not healthy, especially when I have to be pleading my case and showing that I'm confident in the game I've played. But when I'm not feeling confident in myself, it's hard to do.